We ready? Okay.
Okay.
All right, one of the great Irish writers said, being Irish, he has an being Irish, he has a how did that go? Impending sense of tragedy that sustains him through temporary periods of joy. So, this is one of my temporary periods of joy, although I have joy most of the time, tragedy some of the time. You were asking about the Capone stories. My father used to wash cars for his father and in the Canadian Ace Brewing Company, which was at 39th and Union. That was owned by Capone. So my father tells a story at midnight. He was washing the car and Capone showed up with his whole entourage. And with him was Meyer Lansky, who was the Jewish fellow that kept all the books. And he was the mastermind behind the finances of Capone. And so they walked in and my father's washing the cars and Capone stopped and said, "Isn't this wonderful? Look at this young man earning his keep by the sweat of his brow at midnight. I'm going to tell you something, young man. Never take a dishonest dollar." And they all laughed and then they walked on. And Lansky said, "Just a moment." He went back and he said, "There's one exception to that, young man. If you can steal $1 million, take it, because you can always buy your way out of it." So they all laughed again and went on. So this was sort of the characters that inhabited the Bridgeport area. So that was sort of a diversion. Now let's go back to...
You just mentioned your grandfather. Can you tell us a little bit more about your grandparents and your relationship to them?
I had a grandfather, Lamb, was in the tea and coffee business. And he had two wives. His first wife was a beautiful woman who died very, very young. And then he married the second time, and his second wife's father owned a livery with horses and buggies, and she was an only child, so she inherited all these horses and buggies. So my grandfather now ends up being in the livery business and also in the tea and coffee business. And so he had a big stable, when I knew him, of cars, and then he had the tea and coffee in front. And they would always send over these big chests from China of tea, and inside were these beautiful cloisonné lamps and all kinds of stuff, just like, you know, toys in a box. And to this day, we have some magnificent things in our home that after they died, passed down through the family. But he was a short man, and he was very, feisty, you might say. If he was against you, he just didn't say he was against you. He worked very, very diligently against you. So he had, as I call, real good friends and real good enemies. And I think I sort of follow after him much more so than my father. My father was sort of a conciliator. He didn't want to alienate anybody, and he wanted to bury everybody. As I went to work for my grandfather, he owned the business. He owned the livery business. So I worked for all these different funeral homes. And I really felt, as a young man, that this was sort of a bizarre way to live. In fact, one guy told me he goes to 5 barbers. He has his hair cut about every other week. And he goes to a different barber. Perchance someone should die in their family, then they'd call him because he's the undertaker. But he said, "I only like one of the haircuts." So his whole life he walks around with 4 haircuts he doesn't like. You know, what kind of a life is this? So that was another thing that sort of stuck out in my mind as you go through all of these different characters and events. My grandfather was a little cock of the walk, and my father had to make sure when he went in business that everyone knew it was him and not my grandfather, because he didn't want to pick up any of his enemies. And he would meet with all of these tea merchants. And a lot of them became household names in Chicagoland, Jewel Food Store and National. I can't even remember the names of the big Wonder Butternut Bread. All of these people, they used to have breakfast together every day, real early, at the markets. And one would have would inherit something or have an idea, and the rest of them would think about it and say, "Oh, how wonderful it was!" And then they'd go on and form these giant companies that are now running the. A lot of them are just running the food companies of the United States. My grandfather was never into that kind of a. He was more of a one-person, one-man band. My uncle worked for him. My two uncles worked for him, and my father. Then my father worked for a group called Blake, and all the Blakes died very young, and the company was then taken over by the Livestock National Bank to support the young children who were, you know, just in grammar school. So they sold it to my father, and he kept the name Blake because there was another large firm that had founded by the name of Lane, and Lane and Lamb were two, and nobody really knew Lamb, but everybody knew the Blakes. So he kept Blake Lamb, then Blake Lamb, then went on to be the company that I ran. And it was very august. For the 100th anniversary of funeral directing in the United States, the National Funeral Directors Foundation took a year to find the best run funeral home in the country. Blake Lamb was named that. It wasn't because we were loved, because the Illinois contingent got up and left in disgust. And then we won it for the next 4 years. So we ran it won it 5 years in a row, and then they changed the rules that once you ran it, won it twice, that you couldn't get it again. But we always thought that the people should be given the all the service and all of the. It was based upon taking care of people and not taking care of egos and yourself. I used to say publicly, as soon as you got your funeral director's license and your director's suit, you lost your fucking mind. You became the egomaniac. My family's, my this, my that. You know, it has nothing to do with that. It has to do with service. And that had to be driven home constantly, day in and day out. In the funeral business, you build no goodwill. Because you can't say to somebody, "You know, I really fucked up your grandfather's funeral, but wait till your grandmother dies. We're going to have a great time." You just don't get that. And every other business, you can do things great for a year, 2 years, or 10 years, and then you fuck it up, and you say, "Well, you know, I had a hangover," and the guy, "Oh, that's okay." Not in the funeral business. If the name is spelled A-N-N-E, and it's supposed to be A-N-N-E-E, and you left the other E out, you'd think the world was going to end. Or if you've lined the funeral up and car number 2 is in car number 3 position, and car number 3 is in car 2 division, going to the, you absolutely swear that car number 3 was going to be taken to the moon. I mean, people would just get so pissed off over what we consider nothing. Because it's all based upon, you know, who am I, what am I, where am I going? This is my time to show who I am and what I am and all that kind of stuff. I mean, that's part of it. It's not all of it. So paying attention to those details constantly every day, that was my job. I ran 32 different companies. And I used to say to my managers, "I want to know what's going on that's good. I want all the shit on my desk first thing in the morning. Everything that could possibly happen, I want to know about it now. 7 a.m., everything. And then my job is to grow flowers through all that horseshit. Whatever I have to do to straighten it out with these families, that's my job. And I have to go there. I've got to prostrate myself. I got to do whatever I have to do. And I had certain rules. You will never, never, never miss a pickup of the family to go to a funeral. There are no excuses. If you're supposed to pick up a family to take them at 9 a.m. to a 10 o'clock service, if you have to push your car, if you have to commandeer a truck, you pick them up and you get them there. If you do not, that funeral is free. F-R-E-E. No charge whatsoever to that family if you miss it. You are immediately fired. No ifs, ands, whats, or buts. You are fired. The management team of the funeral home pays half the cost. The general manager of the area comes and sits with the family and takes all the shit personally. If they find me and I show up at the funeral, no matter where I am, and the manager is put on 2 weeks suspension, period, no pay. And that's the way the business was run. Rest assured, every family was picked up, period, during the time I ran that business. That may seem harsh, but you can imagine if you've lost somebody and you're going to a funeral and here's some idiot in a limousine supposed to pick you up, and they don't show up, and here's 300 people waiting for you at the biggest and worst time of your life. That's not good. So that's the way, those were the pressures that we worked with all the time. And when you walked in, you were greeted by somebody. And that's, in our society, nobody is a greeter. Everybody's going on to be Frank Sinatra. I really don't greet anybody. I'm Frank Sinatra, or I'm going to be Pavarotti, or I'm going to do this or that. And so you pay for them. In any of my funeral homes, when you walk through the door, someone would walk up and say, "Good afternoon, sir. Who would you like to see?" You'd say, "Oh, I want to see so-and-so." Right this way, show you down, or right down. There could be 5, 6, 7 wakes going on. They'd part with it. That's only common courtesy. I found it impossible to hire people that would do that and keep them at the door, because I would have to go around, and I would, my day would start at 7 and would end at 10 at night. And in the limousine, I was everywhere. And I belonged to the union, so if there was a funeral going out, I could pop the driver out and I'd jump in and drive that car, that hearse. People wouldn't know who the hell I was in many cases, and I could listen to what was going on and see what's happening and talk to the people. So I had a hands-on approach to the work. So I told the managers, if I come in and the guy isn't on, or woman isn't on the door, you are going to be responsible. You miss this for 5 times, and I keep a book and I keep track, you lose your job as manager. You can go back, because I always went from within to bring people forward. You go back to your old position. You might be an embalmer or a driver or whatever you were, but you're not going to be a manager. So in a 6-month period, you can have 4 mistakes. And they'd say, "Well, you know, it's not up to me, it's up to the other person." Anyway, so where are we going now?
Your other grandfather or your grandmother?
Pardon me?
Your other grandfather or your grandmother?
Oh, yeah. My grandmother was from, the Lambs were from Tralee in Ireland, and the grandparents, the Lawlers, were from Mayo, County Mayo. And my grandfather was a butcher, and he was also a grocer. He had one of the first supermarts in Chicago. He used to candle his own eggs. He'd slaughter his own meat. But he had this big store that would deliver. You'd go in and make a big order, and they'd deliver it everywhere. He was quite an entrepreneur. He worked until he was about 84 and had a stroke and died. Same way with my grandfather. Grandpa Lamb, his father was the first meat inspector in the city of Chicago. And he was from Ireland also, and he would condemn the tubercular cattle, because during that time they would sell cattle, they would sell meat tainted and all that. So he'd go there with gasoline and throw it on the carcass and make a big X on it. And they were always trying to run him down with horses and all that kind of stuff. So there were a lot of stories about him. But Grandpa Lawler was a great businessman. They call him the Irish Jew. He was the first one down at the markets every day, picking out his fruits and vegetables to get the best price. They just whittle everybody down. Oh God, here comes the Irish Jew. He was a tall, thin man, and every day, three times a day, he ate steak. He had two cups of tea, a steak, and a little, at dinner time, a little baked potato, and lunchtime, a little vegetable, and breakfast, an egg. And you could set your clock by him. And this is what he ate three times a day. That's exactly what he had. He was a quiet man, but he was a prodder. He just knew exactly what he was doing. He wanted to be a doctor, but his eyes were bad, so he couldn't get into school. So he put his four sons through. So he had four sons that were doctors. And his oldest son, Dr. Richard Lawler, was very famous. He did the first kidney transplant, actually the first transplant in the world at Little Company Mary Hospital. And he and a group, he designed the operation. It was world famous as far as that was concerned, but he never did it again. He never did another transplant, and he didn't want any publicity. And in later life, I said to him, Uncle Dick, why didn't you ever do anything? And he said, I don't want people to know where I live, who I am, or what I've done. He said, he had two daughters. He said, the most important thing in my life are my two daughters. And he said, I think what they did to Lindbergh was so horrendous that his baby was killed because he was famous. And I don't want my children to be kidnapped and murdered because I am famous. He said, I hope everybody forgets about me. But he would go around the world giving lectures to other doctors. He treated the Pope. But he kept a very, very low profile as far as the general public. You never saw him in anything. Then his brother, Ed, he wrote a book which became a bestseller on taking care of children. And then the other two, Paul was a very esteemed obstetrician, and the younger one actually married one of the great tycoons' daughters of the United States, J. Patrick Lannan. So it was quite an interesting family. J. Patrick Lannan was one of the ones that started AT&T and owned railroads and all kinds of things. And Uncle Frank was a very debonair man, and got along very well with J. Patrick.
Your relationship with your grandmothers?
My grandmothers were hard. Well, my one grandmother, Grandmother Lamb, and Grandpa Lamb both had very withering arthritis. Grandpa Lamb fought it and never gave in till the day he died. Grandma Lamb went to bed. And she was in bed for 15, 16 years. I never knew her not being in bed. And she just withered up into a fetal position, her hands and feet and all. And she was a happy person, but she was just, she was in bed. Grandma Lawler was a wonderful meeting of everybody. She was always happy, and she was a heavy-set, small woman. They always had numerous guests in their house. Maggie Lawler's place was the place people would come and stay a year from Ireland. And so there was Joe. Joe was a character. He liked to drink, and you never knew what he was going to do. And Charles was a fireman and a policeman, then Aunt Catherine and my mother, and then the four doctors. And then my mother's family, my father's family, there was Ray, who was a real nut, he was a policeman, and then my father and Ed and Phyllis. Brothers married sisters. So my mother and father my aunt and uncle were brothers and sisters to the, so it was a real close-knit family. And my aunt and uncle, he was an insurance man. They lived in Beverly, which was a very upscale, uptone place to live. And we lived in Bridgeport, which was a real place that was, when the immigrants came, that's where they went. So there was a real dichotomy there of lifestyles. My cousins all went to golf clubs and played tennis and all that. It was so out of my world that I had no idea. So, what else?
You told us not only about your childhood, but your youth, your adolescence. When did you notice, is there a moment in your memory where you noticed that you had become an adult?
No. There really wasn't. I think as a younger person, I thought I knew everything. I was constantly striving all the time to get somewhere, to do something, to be somebody, to for recognition. I dressed, it became a very important thing for me to be dressed correctly, because I think that first impressions are lasting, and the outward package is so important. I wore a lot of jewelry. I had a friend that was wonderful. He was one of the great designers of jewelry, and he would make me all these beautiful big gold things with diamonds and all that. I'd look like one of the gypsies, and I thought I was the cat's meow. And I had a big diamond stick pin that had about 30 diamonds in it with a big one in the middle. And that was the life. I mean, that was riding around in the Lincoln. Didn't have a pot to piss in the window to throw it out. As a great friend of mine used to say, he farts through silk, but he can't get a black kid out of a white school. Or a white kid out of a black school. That's sort of an in-Chicago joke. So, I don't think I ever really grew up. I didn't grow up mentally until my late 50s, I think, or 60s. When I finally really did believe I was going to die, I think I verbalized that a lot. But when I thought of how fragile life is, and that you really only have very few things that you're going to take out of this world, it was a big trauma for me to be sued by the federal government. Because, as I said to my lawyers, I lost my virginity. I thought that there were certain real strong pillars holding everything up, and there aren't. You know, the church is it. It isn't. The government is it. It isn't. You know, the doctors are it. They aren't. There isn't any. It doesn't exist. The only real thing, I think, of power is in yourself, of what you are about. Because the only thing you can control, somewhat, very, very little control, is yourself, nothing else. And if you rely upon other people or other institutions, you're not going to find it, I don't think. So when I went with my lawyers, it was such a flagrant violation of what I felt was my right. I was on the board. I'd gotten off 8 years before the institution went under. I had written a resume of why I thought the whole industry was going to go under because of, I don't even want to get into all the details of it. But when we discovered that we were being sued by the government because we had money, and that was about all. So I said to them, let's pretend like you're a Jew in Nazi, and I said this to my lawyers, that you're a Jew in Nazi Germany in 1939, and the Nazis come into the temple, and I said, I told you Jews not to be praying. Now we're going to have an example. Out! And there's two big posts. And they take two of them and they tie them to the posts. They're putting the things on their heads. And one is yelling, you will never, never destroy the Jewish people. You will never destroy the Jewish faith. And the other one is yelling, quiet, quiet, you'll make them angry. And I said, make them angry. This is still the United States. We will fight. I would rather be dead and broke than give in to those son of a bitches. And that's what we did. And that's what the story is. But it was very, very difficult for me. I found it difficult. I find the thing with the priests very difficult. It's a complete negation of who and what they're supposed to be. My fight with the government was a complete negation of what I felt by the people, for the people, of the people. This is not what this is about. So the institutions stink, I think. Why? Because we don't pay enough attention, that's why. Because, you know, if you can't fuck it, you can't eat it. I don't want to know about it. We better know about it. Because it all comes back to roost. So, what was the question? Yeah, how did that start out with my grandmother?
please do tell us, I think, a very important moment in your life, how you met your wife, and how and when you got married.
Greatest time of my life. We met in the womb. My mother and Rose's mother went to school together. They were lifelong friends. They met in grammar school, and until almost the day they died, they had a group that met and they had cake and coffee together all of their lives. When they were married, they were in each other's wedding. Their husbands knew and liked each other. So I was running around with the gang, and my mother and father decided it's about time he meets some young women. And so little Rosemary Graham was available. And so the two mothers got together, and we were going to go to, I was going to go to the big formal at South Shore Country Club. That was the big thing of the world. And so my mother called her mother, and they fixed it up, and the two of us went on our date. And then we didn't see each other for another year. And then we went on a date again. And then we started really dating. And I would take the streetcar over, and I was supposed to go in the Army. And I was called up on the draft. Oh, I was 20, I think. So that was 50 years ago. So I went down. I had taken a physical a year before that or whatever. And they said, everyone that hadn't had physicals in 6 months, step forward. So I stepped forward. They said, now you have to take a physical. Now I had had going away parties and all that crap, you know, and all that. And they dropped me off, tearful goodbyes. I was going to Fort Benning, Georgia. And so lo and behold, all of a sudden, a bunch of doctors are pounding on my back. And they said, do you have any problem with your back? I said, no. I said, well, you have to take some x-rays. They took some x-rays. And then they said, you've got to come back in 3 months. We're not going to take you because you might be a liability to the Army. We think there's something wrong. I always had back pain, but and my back used to go out and all that. So I thought, well, you know. I said, I don't have any problem. They said, well, if it shows up, and we're liable, blah, blah, blah. So you have to go home for 3 months. I said, oh, well, shit, you know. Now what? So I called my father, and I said, I have to come home. Oh, you know, it's wonderful. I said, I'll take the streetcar. No, 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 take a taxi. Take a taxi. A taxi? I've never been in a goddamn taxi. So I grab a taxi, and he paid for it. And then, so now I have 3 months of waiting. You know, what's going to happen? So I go down, I take the next test, and they said, no, you can't take you in the Army. So I bought a ring for Rose, and I went over, I presented her with the ring, and we got engaged, and we were married October 2nd. It will be 48 years this coming year. And then we started having our children, and we had a little house. We paid $16,100 for it. And I put $1,600 down, everything we had. And the children started coming along, and we just had a great time. But there was always the work. In fact, when Rose was having her first child, Little Company Mary Hospital, it was she always had long labors. So she was in labor for 2 days. I'm in the hospital 2 days, and the phone rings. Pick it up. It's the funeral home. It's a little man. Yes. Rose still in labor? Yes. Well, somebody just died in the hospital. Can you go see them? I said, what are you talking about? And so I did. I went to see them. But I remembered when I was a kid, my mother had a miscarriage. And my two uncles were there. Now this, I forget how young I was, but I was young. And it was like 3 a.m, everybody's up, you know, and my mother's there, and the street doctors are there. And a phone rang, and my father picked it up, and somebody had died. And he was on the phone for about 15 minutes with them. And when it got all over, my uncle said, who was that you're on the phone so long with when your wife's having a miscarriage? He said, you know, they don't give a shit if my wife's having a miscarriage or I'm having a heart attack. Somebody just died in their family, and that's all they care about. And that was the atmosphere that we lived under. It just didn't matter. Your problems are immaterial. And so I wasn't that surprised too much to get that phone call while Rose was in labor. But our children, we'd built this funeral home way out in the middle of nowhere, and there weren't any restaurants around, so we started a practice of having people up for dinner. And we would have sometimes 1,000 people in a month up for dinner at our house, in our apartment, above the funeral home. And the kids would help serve it. We had what was called the dinner, which was rolled ham and potato salad and all that. And that's how we built the business. Rose and I and the kids working day and night. And next to my bed was the telephone. And that every funeral home that I bought, all the lines came right into my house. At 10 o'clock at night, I took every phone call from 10 at night until 8 in the morning. And there were month after month after month that we didn't get a full night's sleep. But I had the ability to be able to pick that phone up, be as lucid, and talk to people, and write everything down, make my phone calls. Once I got through, put that phone down and hit that bed and boom, I'm out. I could still do that, but that was my early training. And Rose was there, you know, helping build the business, all the different organizations, all the different groups that she was president of, this, that, and the other thing. Then we'd go down and we'd work the wakes. We'd greet everybody at the door, and after they got through feeding them, and it was a riot. But that's how we started, and that's how we built this huge business. But after a while, it became so confining. Even though I got out of the everyday running of it, and then I just took over this part of taking care of all the problems. And it wasn't any fun anymore. It wasn't, every day was just a day of trauma, of trying to get through. Okay, and what up?
Well, tell us a bit more about the raising of the children. Who's the oldest?
Matt's the oldest. Matt is a policeman now, and he trains for the Cook County Sheriff's Police. But he trains Navy SEALs. He's got every belt known to man. He's as thin as a rail. He's like a piece of steel. And he was a funeral director, but he hated it. Thank God he got out of it. And he was also a backup drummer for Bachman Turner Overdrive. Great musician. He decided there was just too much drugs and too much alcohol in that whole thing. And so many of his friends killed themselves with the booze and the drugs. So he got out and went from the funeral business. Well, he went into the funeral business, then he got out of the funeral business and went into police work, which he loves. Highly respected man and just a wonderful guy. Rosemarie is our next, and she's now the president of the funeral firm. She's very active in different groups, the president of the Irish Children's Fund, which brings children from North, from Protestant and Catholic into the United States, and lives with U.S. families, and very involved in that. Also, the Circle Rivera dance group, which was a group that I helped found, and she then took over as president of that. And she does all the labor negotiations for Service Corporation International. Very respected in labor relations, extremely well thought of in the union movement and in the management movement. So she has her niche. She's not married. Then there's Colleen. Colleen is married to a wonderful man who's with Osei. She is in training. She does management training for Service Corp. She's the founder of many different groups that are, old age, senior citizens groups, where they get together and she brings in help forms for them, doctors and lawyers to try to help them through their different problems. She's involved with many different political groups. She and Sheila are politicians in our family, and they work hand in glove with many different political groups, both in zoning, in electing different people, running different campaigns. And then Sheila is our baby. She's 40 now. Sheila is my chief assistant. She has a child from the Philippines, and she has an older girl, 11, Rose, and then a baby who's now 4. So she's raising 3 children. She is involved really in the spirit. She's involved with battered women. She was a battered wife. So she works very closely monitoring and helping battered women and battered children. She was in the contest for Mrs. Illinois, so she was Mrs. Illinois, was a finalist in Mrs. United States. This year she was just named Woman of the Year for Mrs. Globe. So she mentors people all over the world, actually, in child abuse and spousal abuse. She'll be going on the radio, I believe, with a radio program. She's also very involved in churches and in the Word of God. She's quasi-minister or priest, whatever. But she's very much into the religious aspect of life and its meaning and how it can be spread throughout the world. So the kids all are very interesting people. They all have very interesting lives. I think that, in fact, I know my 4 children, my wife, are my best friends. And we all huddle together when there's a problem, and we all get together when there's joy. And but we all have our own lives, and it's a good group.
What do you remember from raising the children? You said earlier that what you most regret is not having been there too often or often enough. But which moment do you remember when you think of each of the children?
Well, we would have projects. We decided once that we were all going to go to Spain, so we had 3 years to plan. And we never had any money. Money was very, very scarce. So everybody had to have a job. Colleen was washing cars. Sheila was taking care of horses. Matt was doing gardening work for somebody. Rosemary was a secretarial work, even as kids. And we all threw this money into this pot. And we were going to be gone for a month. And I hadn't taken a vacation then for 2 years. And we had everything planned. And this was going to be our month to get away and, you know, blah, blah, blah. And it was one of the worst blow-ups that I had with my father. Because it came time to leave, and I got my paycheck, and it was for 2 weeks. And I was going to be gone for 6 weeks. I mean, I was supposed to be paid for 2 weeks prior and 4 weeks ahead. That's how we paid the vacation. And he said, well, you know, you only get 2 weeks vacation. That's it. I said, well, I hadn't had a vacation. This has been 3 years now. So I had the other 2 years where I had worked. He said, well, that's not the way it works. And I said, I need that money. I can't go on the vacation. We had everything right down to the pad. And he said, well, that's your problem. That isn't mine. He said, you should have known. You're running the company and you knew the books and you don't, he controlled the payroll. So I said, you miscalculated. So I said, well, you know, you can take your company and your business and you can stick it up your ass. I'm through. And we just had a knockdown, drag-out fight. And he went into his apartment and wouldn't speak for 2 days. And I was livid. I had a great friend, Pat Foley, in Houston, Texas. I was president of the International Funeral Directors Association, and Pat was my mentor. He was a very successful man. So I called Pat, and he said, oh, fuck the old bastard. He said, come and work for me. He said, I have no kids, and you can have my business when I'm dead. And he said, I mean it. He said, you can be my chief guy. I'll double what you're making, and I'll make you my heir. And Rose and I were about ready to leave, and my mother came in with this check and said, here. So I took it and we left. And when we came back, my father and I made up, and that was it. I called Pat and thanked him profusely. And he and I were friends for years, until he died, actually. He had one of the greatest funerals in the world, which is another story. So
do you have any godchildren?
Any what?
Godchildren?
I do, but I'm never in touch with them. I don't even, you know, it isn't one of the priorities.
You've told us already about building the funeral business, growing the funeral business. Tell us a bit more about your community and church involvement.
Well, I was president of the International Funeral Directors Association. It's called PFDI. It was made up of the biggest funeral homes in the country. And I was the youngest one to serve as president. Again, I had great mentors in that group, people that really taught me a lot about organization, and they were a wild bunch. But they were very entrepreneurial, very dedicated, just strong, strong people that knew exactly where they're going and knew exactly how to get there. And they were laser beams, but they also knew how to live. And we had more great parties, we had more fun. But when it came to business, now you're at a table, and there was only one per city allowed. And it was much sought after. You bring in, and the rules were, you could ask any question and you could say anything that you wanted. And if someone took offense to it, they should get out. And if I said to you, I want to know how much money you earn, I want to know how much money your business earns, I want to know how much drops to the bottom line, and you don't tell me, then you're out of this group. Period. That's all. First meeting I went to, this guy gets up, and they were talking about something, and he starts talking about one of his grandkids. He no more had the first sentence out, and somebody said, "Listen, you son of a bitch, I came all the way from California here not to listen to this bullshit. Now, if you don't have anything else to say about the subject, I don't want to hear about your grandson. Sit down, shut up, get out, or talk on the subject." And that's it. I mean, that's the way these guys acted. In the meeting, it was cutthroat. They cut your head off. Some of the most bizarre things I've ever seen in my life. One guy came in with this plan, and Pat Foley was crazy. He was really a strong, strong businessman, but he was as nutty as they come, and multimillionaire, self-made. So a guy came and he hands out all these different things. He was so proud of this plan. He was going to revolutionize funeral service, and I'd have to stand up to do it. But we're all reading this plan. He says, "No, I'm going to give you 15 minutes to read it, and then we're going to critique it." Everybody read it. It was a stupid plan. And so Foley said, "I'll go first." So Pat stands up, and he's got the plan. And I'll never forget it. He has it open, and he flips the back of his coat up, and he wipes his ass. Throws it on the floor and walks out. I can see it in my mind's eye right now. Everybody stood. And the guy that says, "Am I to infer by that you don't like it?" And Foley says, "Well, if you infer anything else, you're dumber than I thought you were." But that group was incredible. It was just a group that was, I don't think could be reconstructed under all of the rules and regulations nowadays of being correct in all everything you do. They weren't correct in anything that they did. But boy, you really learned from these people. What was the question? I don't know how I even got on these. Okay, well, that was, yeah. So then I'm a Knight of Malta. I was knighted by the Pope. Knight of the Equestrian Order of the Holy Sepulchre of Jerusalem. I spent 8 years as the president of that group in the Midwest. Traveled around the world with that. We started the Crusade of Prayer with Cardinal Caprio and Cardinal Bernardine. Everyone praying together for peace in the Holy Land. That's a worldwide organization. I founded the first group of Christian Muslims and Jews to pray together on common ground in their own tradition for peace in Jerusalem. And that was endorsed by the Pope. It took a long time to get that through. I was on the Vatican Museum. I started the organization to get the Vatican Museum to have all of their outreach programs to be about tolerance and hope and peace, using art again for common ground, so that when a piece of art went out, it just wasn't a piece of art from the Vatican. It was a piece of art that was Catholic and Muslim, or Catholic and Jewish, Catholic and Buddhist, always so that so when a piece of art or an art group came, it just wasn't indigenous to the Roman Catholic society. It was indigenous to the Roman Catholic society as an open. Many different organizations that I was involved with, the president of the high school alumni group. I ran political campaigns. I was on the central committee of the Democratic Party in Worth Township. We used to go door to door, and I worked for the Republicans and the Democrats at different points in time, depending on who was running. So we would actually go out and ring doorbells, picket, do all kinds of stuff. Everybody was appalled. The funeral director's involved in this. You're not supposed to piss off anybody. Very involved with the Greek church. I loved the Greeks and ran many campaigns and different things for them. I was lobbying. I lobbied for different political forces, both in Chicago, Springfield, and Washington. And that was always fun. Founded the Circa Rivera group, which is, I thought there was just too much going on about the negativeness of art. And I had a group over about the counterbalance of the piss Christ and walking on the flag. And they were all young, and they were all gay, but they were just wonderful people and wonderful artists. And I said, you know, if there's anyone that's going to be really put down, it's the gay community. And so we founded this group, and a year later they came out, and I do all the staging for them. It's one of the main groups now in Chicago. So what else?
Carol, you mentioned the family trip to Spain. When was your
I went up and I said to Rose, I think we should go to Europe. And she said, we don't have time. We're too busy. And I said, yeah, I know we don't have time. I want you to come down and go to 5 wakes. You'll see 5 people under 35. They're all dead. They don't have any time. So we had, TWA used to have trips. So we took London, Paris, Rome for $700 and some odd, including everything. And so that was our first going into Europe. And we were just smitten with it. We were absolutely enthralled with what we saw. So from that time on, it was one of our priorities to get away. And for years, what we would do would be just get a map, drop into somewhere, pick up a car, and go. We'd spend 3 or 4 weeks. The more we got accustomed to being able to be away, I had a good management staff, we just did it. Rose became a travel writer, and she was an excellent travel writer. It was syndicated in the Southtown newspapers. There were some 30 or 40 different newspapers. And we had great adventures in our travels. We could write a book about just the travel part. We were up in the Himalayas. We were down the Amazon River. We were in Egypt, or not Egypt, and Greece many times. It's just the whole travel situation was a real reawakening of my inner spirit, because the thing I got out of my travel is that everybody's different, but everyone's the same. Every place we went, we got to know the people. And I didn't, after we did the TWA tours, I never went with American groups anymore. I would pick up a group in London or somewhere. So it would be a mixture of other peoples. So we weren't always getting the same sort of a message. we weren't just taking the United States with us as we went, staying in the Hilton Hotel. We traveled with a group of people that looked after the ecology of the world, and they were out of London. And we were able to meet all of these different people that were involved with rainfalls and droughts and all of those kind of things, which, and then you got into the politics of it, the human part of it, and then you'd have discussions as you're riding along with these people. So it was not only looking at the geography and the beauty, but it was also the underlying problems of humanity, which again, I found always the same. The individual people all have the same aspirations. It's the leaderships that I think are subjective. They subject everything to what their particular agenda is. So that I believe that when I founded the prayer group, there's no leadership. There's nothing written. It's all from the bottom up. Because if it goes from the top down, I think it has a lot of baggage with it. It has preconceived notions. It has, you must do this, you must do that. When you're dealing with people and people, it's, you know, it can be done this way or it can be done that way. And that's really the thoughts that I had. When you look at different cultures, you see the same thing being done, only it's done in a different way, but a completely acceptable way. That's the broadening of travel. So because of our travel, we really have encouraged our children to go other places. And when we met the Rhodas, Dominic and Leah, really empowered us to try to get our grandchildren to be able to speak many different languages, to be able to live in many different locations and feel much more comfortable than our children feel now the same way we do. But I'd like my grandchildren to if they could, to go up another step and really feel like they were citizens of the world. So travel is important. Travel is very broadening. Travel gives you the reality of possibilities. And also the realization that you don't have all the answers and that people do things differently. But they're happy, and so what?
But you've also sent your daughters to school in Europe.
Yes, we did. And it was not a traditional school as such. They went to class 2 days a week, and they traveled the other three. And the travel was structured, and it was within the whole curricula of the school. And they came back different people.
So all four went?
No. Sheila did not go, and Matt didn't go, because they are not our students. They're like me. Colleen and Rose are students, and Sheila and Matt are not. Rose is a student, and I'm not. They learn by structure. We learn by doing, you might say. So they did other things. Matt traveled with a rock band for a while, and Sheila, you know, she did many things, and probably a lot of things we don't know about all of them, which is fine. And but they've all had their experiences. Now, as far as probably the one that is the most traveled is Sheila, because now she is moving around with somewhat my art career, but as the Mrs. Illinois and all of that.
Also with her own art.
Pardon me?
Also with her own art.
Yes, right. And she spent a lot of time over in Germany with Willeroy and Bach. So, you know, everything has a time and a place.
Tell us a little bit about your Peruvian engagements.
Well, Bishop John McNabb was a great friend of ours. And he was, well, he wasn't a bishop, he was just a librarian. And he was an Augustinian. And they wanted to have a revolution was going to take place in Peru. And Rome decided it would either be a communistic revolution or it'd be a Christian revolution. There was the oligarchy had an unholy alliance with the top people to subjugate all of the people to really keep them down. And the seething was then used, of course, by the Shining Path, which is a communistic force, using the Khmer Rouge tactics of terror. So, John McNabb was then appointed to go to Peru and found a missionary group. He didn't know how to speak Spanish. He was a librarian. And so he reached out to us, so we formed a couple of groups called the Chulucanas Fellows and the Chulucanas Mission Club to raise money and to give him support. Now, we didn't have any money ourselves, so we had this crazy, wild, drunken party. Everybody got well liquored up, and then we had a note for $60,000, which we all signed, and we woke up the next day wondering, what the hell did we do? Then we had to raise the money, and he then asked us to when he became a bishop, to be in charge of all of the celebration that went along with it. And that was the first time that a lay person was doing that. So we had a ball doing that. And that's another whole story, but it'd take it forever to tell that one. But Cardinal Cody, we got him to pay for it. And we just pulled all kinds of tricks out of it and had a ball. So anyway, McNabb goes to Peru, and as he said, he cried himself to sleep every night. Here he is, an American, a gringo, can't speak the language, in a place where there's no air, there's no water, and nobody knows who the hell he is and what he's supposed to be doing. And the priests are the ones that are corrupt. And he said he'd go into a town, they'd spray painted Yankee Go Home, and he knew damn well it was the priest, because the priest was the only one that could write. And so he said, well, the first thing we're going to do is educate the kids. But he said all the kids are drunk because they have chicha, which was like 180 proof. They all hang a sign outside of their house when the chicha is right. First thing in the morning, the kids get a glass of chicha, and then they're stoned all day long. And you know, they go take a leak on the street. And he said, you know, it's crazy. So what we're going to do is we're going to get the kids sobered up first. So we'll have a bakery, and then we'll have a dairy. So we raise money. And we said, you know, we can't keep raising money and giving money to them. Why the hell, we don't have any money ourselves. Let's take a core amount of money. Let's lend it to the people. Then they have to pay us back. So let's make it an ongoing process. So that's what we did. So instead of saying, oh, you know, let's go buy all kinds of milk, and let's find some people that really know what the hell they're doing, find some cows, find some milking machines, put it all together. We'll buy it all. They'll sell the milk. They'll get the money back, and then we'll get the money back, and we'll keep working that way. So that's what we did. So it took a couple of years, and the kids are then, you know, drinking milk and eating bread instead of being stoned. So then let's work on, you know, if you're going to piss on the street, go somewhere else. Let's start getting something about water and sewerage, and how can we talk about social justice and all that when let's start getting to the basics before we start talking about who we are and the Roman Catholic Church and all that kind of stuff. The priests are running around married and with girlfriends and, you know, having carnivals and keeping all the money and all that kind of stuff. Let's get all this stuff straightened out so the people themselves have a better life. And then they'll come back. So this became very foreign to the oligarchy, and they were very afraid of this. So they started to shut everything down, because then we started a co-op where they could buy their own seed, because the way they were controlled was, we'll sell you the seed, but you owe, when the crop comes in, you owe as much money to us as the seed costs, so you never got ahead. You might get 10 or 20%, you could, you know, screw yourself around or whatever. So we said, well, the hell with this, we're going to buy the seed, we'll set up a co-op, boom. So then they said, well, we're not going to transport, can't use any of our trucks. So we said, fine. So we bought trucks, and then we couldn't get gas, so we bought a gas station. And we put all these people into jobs. So now we have people who own a gas station, people who own trucks, our co-op doing the corn and all the stuff, and it starts coming around, you know, and people got en masse for what they were, and there were big carnivals that were used to, you know, scrape a lot of money out of them. Out of the economy, and that really, you know, got recycled back into the oligarchy and split up by all the people that were on the top, including the priests. And that was very, very troubling. And so our people, you know, were threatened, and life was threatened, and all kinds of stuff. So the other thing that happened was, as he brought in more people, that was very isolated. So, you know, somebody would be up in the mountains somewhere, and they weren't able to talk to anybody that had anything in common with them. So then we set up a radio station. So each one had their own radio station, and then at a certain time every night, everybody got on, they were all able to talk. Then the El Nino current came in, and everything got destroyed because there was so much rain, and this was an arid place, that the animals couldn't even walk. So now we can get around. So we went and we were able to scrounge up an airplane, we got a pilot, and then we had the people build airports, which were just big grass things, and we were able to fly the bishop and food and everything from place to place. Then when that switched around, then we sold the airplane and got the money for something else. But it's been, and then the people themselves were brought up into little clusters. And so there's about 20 in a cluster. They have their own leaders. They have their own Bible studies. They have their own. The other thing that we did was the lay leadership training, where in each town, the person was elected to come and become a leader. And we had leadership places, or we still do, where they are schooled into how to govern yourself, how to all the basic principles that you know. Well, because the leadership at that point were the old leadership. They would elect the town prostitute or the town drunk and send them down to leadership school. And now, those are the people, the old town drunk or the old prostitute, that are the leaders of this whole communities. And there are 40,000 lay leaders now in this part of the world running the whole operation. And it's the, he was marked for death by Shining Path. His house was blown up a couple of times. Rose and I were there, lived with them for a while. That was another whole story. You'd be shot on sight if you were out. It was really an adventure. Our kids thought we were killed and all kinds of stuff. But it's one of the most important things that I've done. Not that I've done. It's the most important thing that I've been involved with. He's now retired. He's 73. He was the youngest bishop in the world when he was. But what a success story, what he has left behind. And we have one rule, no brick and mortar. No brick and mortar. The only thing we will build and invest in is people and ideas. We will lend money, then you got to put it to use. If you lose it all, then the next party doesn't have the chance.
When did that project start?
About close to 40 years ago. Yeah, it's a real success.
You involved with St. Xavier University?
Yeah. I was on the board of St. Xavier's. I was chairman of the curricular activity on the executive board. It's a Southside school, university. We started expanding throughout the world. We had a division in Paris and one in Rome, or Milan. It was an interesting time to be involved in the, at that particular time, I was on that board and on the hospital board. And this is when changes were really taking place, where the federal government had gone in the hospitals of cost plus to cost containment. And to be able to help guide that whole process through was a very trying but satisfying exercise. So those particular boards were important. The visions that they had were good. My involvement with them was, I enjoyed it. Both of the institutions were owned and operated by nuns. They're an interesting group to deal with. And sometimes you really have to bring them up. I mean, they are wonderful, but sometimes the mission becomes the important thing, which it should be, but if the mission is in conflict with the document that you, if you went out and borrowed $60 million and Goldman Sachs has underwritten the thing, they're not interested in your mission, they're interested in what the document says. So trying to bring a religious organization into a financial situation is, in some cases, a chore. But they were very open.
When and where did you first meet with the Pope?
One of my goals was to have one of my pieces put into the Vatican Museum. Professor Persigotti became a friend. He was the director of the Vatican Museums, and we did a number of things with him. Through him, over a period of 5 years, he presented it to the committees, and they selected a piece to go into the Vatican Museum. So I was, Rose and I were invited to the unveiling of the Sistine Chapel, the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel. And the patrons of the Vatican Museum from around the world were invited to go to that event. And that night at the formal dinner was the unveiling of my painting that was going to go into the Vatican Museum. So Rose and I were in our hotel room the night before, or no, 2 nights before, and the phone rang and a voice said, "This is Monsignor so-and-so, the assistant to the Holy Father, and he'd like you to come to his apartment at 6 o'clock tomorrow morning for Mass. Can you come?" "Can we come? Will you be there?" So 5:30, we're there with our nose pressed against the bronze door, ready to go in. And we went into a small, ushered into this small chapel. The Pope was already there praying and attended this Mass with probably 20 other people. And then we were escorted out to an anteroom, and the Pope then came in, and I had one of my catalogs with a picture of the painting. And when he came, I said, "Holy Father, you are now an owner of a lamb painting." And I showed it to him. He said, "Oh, you know," he said, "wonderful." We talked about it 30 seconds or whatever. But it was a thrilling, thrilling time. And then he went on. Then over the years, we have been invited back for the Mass. And the last time we saw him was we were in Rome for the first Senate of the, well, at the same time we were in Rome, was the first Senate of the African Church. And we were invited to go up and sit in the front and witness this spectacular event with all the feathers and the drums. And it was the first time that the African Church had gotten together, and the first time that all of the hidden problems of the Church were discussed, the amalgamation of paganism and Christianity, and tribal lore and Christianity, and all the things that were seething in the African Church. So he, with us was a priest that was a linguist. The Pope spoke in like 15 different dialects, and I don't know how many other languages. And I said to him, "Is he saying the same thing over and over again?" He said, "Oh no." He said, "This is like a chapter of each one." It was incredible. And so in the midst of this, Mother Teresa is pushed in a wheelchair. And we had just heard she was in New York dying. And here she is, from here to where you're sitting from us. And you know, everybody has just gone crazy. All of these very distinguished, very righteous, you know, people, "Mother Teresa," you know, they're running down, flitting around, they're like butterflies. And she's surrounded by her nuns, you know, keeping everybody away. Anyway, when it came time of the break, the Pope came down. And here they are, the two titans of the Church, embraced. It was incredible. And then he went back to the altar, and then she was wheeled away. A week later, she must have been put on a plane. A week later, she was dead, or 2 weeks later, in Calcutta. But the Pope is an incredible person. Absolutely, I think a paradox in many ways. He has got the ability to bring so many people together, but he also has the ability to really grind on other people. So whenever you hear about, "Oh, he's dying, you know, that's the latent hopes of his enemies. But so we've seen the Pope, and as I said, I've been knighted twice by him. And
you've had a chance to celebrate Mass in his private chapel.
Yeah, right. I really think he's a mystic. I think I think he has otherworld sense. I really believe that he is in touch with the spirits, which again is what my heart is all about. I believe right now, right here, we're completely surrounded by the spirits. And they can either help us or they can ignore us. They won't hurt us, but they are the power. They're the power of the other world, where we're going. That's why we're always at such odds with ourselves, because we're trapped in this body, but we are destined over here. So we have the constant pulling and pushing against ourselves. We never know, you know, what we want. But what we want is some sort of evenness. And to find that evenness is impossible forever. I mean, you can find it you get spurts of it. You got to work at it.
So would you consider the Holy Spirit and the guardian angels to be your best or strongest allies?
Absolutely. If it wasn't for the Holy Spirit and the guardian angels, I'd be long dead and probably in hell. I think that they are the ones that completely... I just turned my whole life over them. When we talked about the government, Rose and I had people praying for us all over the world, everywhere. And when we had the interview with the lawyers, whatever they call it, I can't remember the name, where they take your statement and all of that, and they had all these government lawyers and my lawyers, we prayed for a phalanx of angels to protect me. And there was a phalanx of angels protecting me, believe me. Because things happened that my lawyers were astounded. Absolutely, positively astounded with. Because they would say, now we're talking about 20 years before, say, did you see this document? You know, they give you a document this big. And this says this, this, and this. I said, no, you know, where is this document coming from? Texas. Why would I have seen it, you know, if it came from Texas? Well, you know, it had to be okayed by the executive committee, and it was for over $7 million, and blah, blah, blah. So you're in contempt for doing that. And I grabbed the document and flipped it open. Just, you know, boom, put my glasses on, and here a little thing says, unless this is okayed by the board of directors, within 6 months it's null and void. Which completely blew them out of the... So I said, well, did you read on page 635 this? What? I said, doesn't that say that this is not, your whole argument's null and void? My lawyer said, yes, it did. Let me see that. Look at this. How did this happen? I said, I'll tell you later. And then they said to me, another point, you know that so-and-so was a bad man, he did this and he did that, and you gave him money to do this property down in Florida, and on and on and on. Do you remember him? Now, this was, again, 15, 20 years before. I said, oh, yeah. He said, I think you'll find he was a pilot. He was in the Army, and then he got in the Air Force. He flew his own planes. He built all these things that you're talking about for the federal government. He's now working for the federal government. I think if you find his records... And you people are with the federal government, I'm sure you can find his records, you'll see that he's a very noted appraiser for the government, working for them right now. And he's probably on your payroll. and you say that he's a very despicable character, I think you'll find you're wrong. The next day they came in, they said, how did you know that? I said, ask my lawyers. So the phalanx of angels I believe in. The Holy Spirit I believe in. People think you're crazy, but I've seen it. With Rose, I've seen it, because she had polyps in her colon. Now I'm going back again 30 years, 40 years maybe. And for years and years, my uncles were all doctors. They took all these x-rays of hers. They had x-ray after x-ray. Every year they're watching it. And 1 year Dick called up and he said, this is growing. He said, it could be cancer. That's not good. It's not stable. So there's two doctors you go to see. One was in Chicago and one's in New York. These are the only two they allow you to go to see because they're both the best. He said, well, we'll go to the one in Chicago if he's great. Said, yes, he's a friend of mine, Dr. Goldberg, blah, blah, blah. So he said, I'll set it up and you bring the x-rays. So we bring in these pile of x-rays and she's in there in the morning, and they took x-rays, and the doctor comes in, he puts the x-rays up, there, this is what we're gonna do, and at that point, this was the time when they go through the rectum, they don't make the cuts, and they have the little camera and all that. It was just starting of all that. He says, this is what we're gonna do. But he said, if we get to this point and this polyp is too big, we're gonna have to open her up and take it out, because, so now you're gonna have to sign. So we had called all over the world again to all of our friends and said, we need prayers. And we need prayers now about Rose. So she goes in, she's in 3 hours. And they're supposed to be like 1 hour at the most. And the doctor comes out and he says, come with me. So we go in, he puts the thing, he says, there. He says, you see that? I said, yes. He said, we went in and out for 3 hours. He said, it's not there. It is not there. He said, I can tell you unequivocally that last night, this is what was there. Today, it's not there. What's going on? I said, you wouldn't believe me if I told you. So, when you talk about the spirit, this is my feeling of the spirit. And everything that we want, you know, we're not going to get. Because some of the things I wanted the most in my life, I didn't get. And it turned out to be the best thing that ever happened to me down the road. So we don't know where we're going. We don't know how the hell we're going to get there. And it's immaterial. I mean, from here to here is our life. But I absolutely believe that there's a power there that can help us, and that can guide us, and that can really be our strength.
Any other special things protecting you?
I can't say there is. No. Padre Pio was always a great friend of mine. I never knew him, but I used to send him messages all the time. And this is Monsignor Scriba, the head of the Opus Dei Order. A little Peter and Paul. I've worn this for many, many years. In fact, I've worn it for 40 some odd years, ever since they gave it to me in Rome. So, both of those men are now saints. The souls in purgatory were always my friends. Because I often thought that, you know, if you're in trouble, you need some help. So, I always knew I needed help, so anything I could do for the souls in purgatory. That was the old, you know, nuns sort of looking towards. Peter was quite a character. He seemed dumb in many cases. So I think he was sort of probably why I looked up to him. Paul, again, was quite a character, too, you know, getting thrown off his horse and beat the shit out of him. Then he changed. So.
Maybe we could move towards your new life and your second career. What exactly were the events leading up to your decision to become an artist? And when did this all happen?
This was in the 80s, about 84, 85. For years, I was getting what I called, I had mononucleosis, and I had mono days, which was mono months, where I would be just completely wiped out. I couldn't move. But then they would go away. So all of a sudden, I had these mono months where I couldn't get over it. And I didn't know what was the problem. So I went through a whole battery of tests and had biopsies done. And I was told I had chronic active hepatitis and sarcoidosis of the liver. And that I was buying all kinds of businesses. So I said to Rose, you know, I better see if I'm going to be able to pay back all these millions of dollars that I'm borrowing, whether I'm going to live long enough. And because I really feel like shit. And so they gave me that diagnosis, and I was with a lawyer. I was negotiating a big deal, and he said, I've got to leave. He said, I've got to leave for a week. My brother's dying. I said, oh, I'm really sorry. He said, he was 2 weeks ago, he was fine. He just felt terrible, and he lived in Indianapolis, very successful man. He went in, he had all kinds of tests. They found that he had sarcoidosis of the liver and chronic active hepatitis. He'll be dead in 2 weeks. Now, I'm buying, so I didn't say a word. My brother didn't even know this, that I had gotten that diagnosis. Because if the word got out, you know, no one was going to sell me anything. I said, holy shit. And so, about 3 days later, the guy's brother did die. And he went down, and then he came back and started negotiating again. So, anyway, I said to Rose, I had accomplished everything in my life that I wanted to. I don't have any regrets about what I've done, with the exception that I think I could make strong political, social, and economic statements through art. And if I beat this, I'm going to turn my life over to the Holy Spirit, and that's what I'm going to do. So our doctor, who was a great friend, said, you know, you better go and start really figuring out what you're going to do with all this stuff, because you got a lot of loose ends, a lot of things going on. So Rose and I did. We took a week. We went to the islands, and we did a lot of soul searching, crying, carrying on, thinking about what we're going to do. So when we came back, he said, I want you to go up and see my friends in Mayo. He said, I've sent everything up there. They're going to do a complete workup on you. So we did. We spent a week, and when it was all over, we went into a room, and the doctor said, you don't have anything. You got nothing. You don't have chronic active hepatitis. You don't have sarcoidosis. He said, the thing that's going to kill you in your life is stress. He said, running around like a madman, like high blood pressure. But, you know, you're not going to die from those other two things. And so I said to Rose that I'm going to quit and I'm going to become an artist. I know nothing about art, but I always knew that I wanted, in fact, I'd always say, I look at something beautiful. I wish I would have brought my paints. I went into an art store and I said, I have no idea what I need. Just give me a bunch of stuff. I loaded up the back of a car with a whole bunch of things, took it to the apartment and started painting, and been doing it ever since. Where all that comes from, why it all happened, I don't like to look a gift horse in the mouth. It's there, it happens, whatever it is. You know, maybe I do have sarcoidosis and chronic active hepatitis. I haven't gone back. My doctors are either retired or dead. And that's, I was 40-some, 47, I think, 46. Now I'm 70. So I'm maybe a survivor, but if you asked me, before about the spirit, I will live as long as it's time for me to die, then I'll die. But between now and then, I will continue to try to bring the message forward in many different forms. I've been somewhat criticized by people for making too much art. You know, oh, you're cheapening it, you know. It reminds me of Mozart when the king said, too many notes. You know, don't put so many notes in the music. Don't make so much music. I'm going to make the art as long as I have the breath in my body and the strength to do it, because that's what I have to do. And that's what I love to do, and that's what I want to do. And I'll be constantly, constantly delving further and further into the spirit to find out what more is there or what less is there. Where is this going to bring me? It is a real exploration for me. It is a real journey and pilgrimage that I'm on of finding who I am, where I am, where I'm going, what I'm doing, how I'm going to get there. And bringing whatever discussion to the world, because we have to talk about things. We have to talk about things that are painful. We have to talk about things that are happy. We have to talk about things that are controversial. If we talk, we don't kill. Probably. So.
So really, the decision to quit business as usual and start painting was made on the islands before.
No, well, no, that was when I said to Rose, if I ever beat this, this is what I'm going to do. I'm not going to go back to my old life. Because when you're actually confronted with your own death, even though you work with death every day, you don't really believe it. Someone comes up to you and says, yeah, you're probably going to be dead in 3 to 5 years. Maybe yes, maybe no, maybe you aren't. I mean, it wasn't to say, going to write your prescription and hand it to you and say you're going to be dead. People say to me sometimes when I speak into groups, you know, are you worried about the end of the world? You know, the answer to that is, you can easily find out when the end of the world is. Call your insurance man. He'll go to the actuary. He'll look at your health records. He'll look at your age. Look at your general. He can probably tell within 12 months when you're going to die. And that's the end of your world. So why worry about the end of this world? So, you know, who cares about that? So, but when you actually confront the world, the end of your world, it gives you a completely different philosophy, I think, on life. As I said earlier, I really knew that I'm going to die because I work with death all the time. But I think that was mouthing words. When you're actually up against it, then that becomes reality. That then becomes a pivotal point, I believe, in your life, or could become. It was a pivotal point in my life. I don't know what would be anybody else's life. But I just didn't want to, not that I didn't like what I was doing. It was time to move on. It was time to do something that I feel I was destined to do. Maybe that's a lot of bullshit. Maybe it's something I'm, you know, making up in my mind. I don't know. Because I don't really know what we know. That's the other thing I've learned. The older I get, the more I know how little I know. I don't think I'm gaining any knowledge. I think the knowledge I'm gaining is that I don't have much knowledge. And the other thing I'm completely convinced of, I have absolutely no control. I don't have any control of anything, what anyone else does. And I have very little control over what I do. You know, I'm driven to do what I do, but I don't think I can control it.
Going back to your development as an artist, the birth of an artist, maybe you can go back to that day where you went into this shop and started buying things without knowing what you were going to do.
That was not the day I became an artist. It took me years to even mouth the words to myself, you're an artist. Because I didn't like what I was doing as far as when I looked at it. Although I look at it now and I somewhat like it. But I couldn't say I was an artist because I didn't know what an artist was. When I finally figured out what an artist is, I hate labels because they categorize people. But about 4 years after even after I had a one-person show, I couldn't say I was an artist. Because there was a great mystique about being an artist. I think an artist is someone that depends upon on how you're going to categorize artists. But to me, an artist is someone that tries to take something they believe in or think about in the way of mental pictures and turn them into something that can be put on a paper or a canvas and discussed with themselves. And it's all subconscious. It's not a conscious effort, it's a subconscious. What happens on that canvas dictates it, not from me to it, it's from it to me. So it's getting inside of it, which again is a manifestation of who I am. Otherwise it couldn't be a lamp painting. But where does it come from? it comes, where does an idea come from? Where does a thought, how can you get three different things and come up with one idea which is different than the other three? So it's melting back, a synthesization. So that's what happens here. Always constantly synthesizing different things to come forward in different ways, so it's presented to the world as whatever it is. So again, the question is this art or is this philosophy? It's a philosophy that's manifested through art, I think. Or you can turn it around, you could say it's art that becomes philosophy because it's manifested by what I think is my philosophy. But on the other hand, if you look at it, and I say people look at things through their own filter, then it becomes something different to them than it is to me. That's why I don't name them. So that particular situation, it then becomes art again, because then the art is interpreted by the person that looks at it. So is it important for me, for the looker, viewer, to know what I'm thinking about when I'm doing that?
You've just said that you didn't like your first pieces of artwork when you were looking at them then. Today, you can find some sympathy for them. Can you describe your early art?
Yes, I was very, very afraid of color. Black and white was, God, it just traumatized me. Am I going to make gray? Can I put all these together and become brown? What a horrible thing that happened. There was no intercourse between them. If you look at my first, and I didn't use a brush, because a brush you had to run through it, and on the edges then you'd get an integration and a migration of the colors, and a third or fourth color would appear. God, that was not to be done. So I used knives, all kinds of paint with knives, and perchance something should get out of place, even though it was a slashing mode. It was like a beacon coming out of me. God, what am I going to do about this? You know, and then another thing would happen, boom, 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 boom. So I developed that theme till one night I woke up in the middle of the night with the thought that nothing that I can do to color can harm me, and nothing that color can do to me can harm it. So I couldn't harm color, color can't harm me, so why don't you just jump in and do the color and start the intercourse between the colors, start the conversation. And that was the big revolution to me. To be able to jump in and do that with just gay abandon, I just did, boom. And from that point on, anything I could do to present color in a different way, I did. Using water with color, concrete, gesso, fire, turpentine, wipe it off, put it on, pool it, whatever. There was no boundaries, no rules. Color and I were one. Still have them. Color is my friend.
How would you describe the various phases in the growth of an artist? Is there steps you've taken?
Not consciously. The best thing for me as an artist is to forget that I'm an artist. Because it's not about being an artist, it's about making things that are people call art. It is the delving inside of myself to find not a better but a different way of presenting what I'm trying to do, so that each day becomes a challenge and a discovery. Finding that gem in there is so important. That discovery is so important. And now I have in my repertoire many different ways of able to solve the problems. When I first started, there were very few arrows in my quiver, as they say. Now there's all kinds of ways that I can attack a particular canvas or a project. I can do it this way, or I can do it that way, or I can do it three different ways, and nothing that's going to happen and is going to be surprising to me. Might be new, but it's not going to be surprising. And it's not going to be unacceptable, because it's like having a child. That's why I say when I go back to my old paintings, they're like my first children. And in them is the genesis of what I'm doing now. And when I looked at them before, I thought, when I was doing them, this is so rudimental, this is so nothing. But unless I was there, I can't be here. Unless I'm here, I can't go to the next place. I've got to keep going through, you know, it's like growing flowers through a lot of shit. A few years ago, I was on public radio, and they said, what do you do when you get up every morning? I said, I puke on the canvas, and I try to make some sense out of it. So it's, and that's what I think life is. I think life is a big, God knows what. You know, we're walking along all the time. Are we going to get blown up? Are we going to have flowers thrown on us? What's going to happen? Who knows? We don't know. But it's exciting. And the world of my art is so exciting to me. It is my dreadest moment would be if someone said to me, you can't paint anymore. You can't do this anymore. That would be worse than saying to me, like before, you've got sarcoidosis and chronic, you're going to die. That's not the ultimate horrible point in my life.
So are the paintings today your grown-ups?
Are the paintings today my grown-ups? No, they're all my children. Because finding my child every day in this world is my passion. Because I believe to be truly happy, to find your bliss, is to find your child. You can't find your child, then you find the grown-up, which is sophisticated, beat up, arrogant egos. And away we go. Hello, Vietnam. So we have a little song. Okay. Mr. Dominic, ask me.
Thank you, Ricky, for all this good.
What? I didn't hear it.
What are your major projects throughout the world?
Well, there are many. There are some. There are a few. I was doing a trilogy On my way to doing a trilogy, one of them got dropped off. First was about acceptance, and that was with the Blessed Mother, which hangs in the Sorrowful Mother Chapel in the Pontifical North American College in Rome, part of the Vatican. And it's about, be it done unto me according to thy word. Actually, it's a commentary on how whatever comes along, we can accept it, so that we went from that to hope to love. The hope was really the Millennium piece that I did for St. Thomas University. It's 64 feet by 12 feet. And it's about hope of the world. It started off to be a beginning, a middle, and an end. But it turned out to be a beginning, a middle, and a beginning again. So it's the divine circle. The spirit is very much involved in that particular painting. And it was supposed to be shown in the Mall of America under the auspices of St. Thomas University. I did a love and hope painting, which is a huge canvas, 30 feet long by 20 feet wide. I have now used that, and I am using it in the love panels. So my original thought was to have the acceptance, hope, at the Mall of America, and then to finish with the Westminster Cathedral, which are the love panels. And that's 144 feet by 12 feet, divided up into 12 panels, each one 10 by 12. And then the entrance balance of hope and love. That was shown in the Westminster Cathedral for the Millennium celebration. After 4 years of planning with the St. Thomas the Mall of America, the last 4 weeks it was canceled by some unknown force and never did take place. So the trilogy became a duo. And the hope piece is hoping to be shown. It's in a storage facility that's rented by the St. Thomas University. I don't know what's going to happen to it, but it's, you know, one of those things. I find that many of the projects just sort of disappear for many and varied reasons. I think that anything that has anything to do with hope and peace and tolerance and understanding and all the kinds of things that we talk about, there's a whole counterbalance about destruction and killing and envy and all that. And so there are other forces working in the world. Two of the projects which have evaporated were the Ingurta Moor, which were the two projects, one in Ireland and one in Chicago, about the plight of the Irish as they left Ireland. And most of those memorials show starving children and skeletons coming out of graves. But I think that my memorial was about despair, hope, and triumph. How the Irish people triumphed over the dastardly place. I did a project for the Spiritus Museum of Judaica. And again, it was about despair, hope, and triumph. It's a painting that's in their Kristallnacht series. It's taken out once a year in the memorialization of Kristallnacht. It has a black border, and it's framed in barbed wire, so that they'll always know that they were in torment and in prison. But the painting is not joyous, but it is triumphal, because at the end of it, this white force is coming out, which is the beginning of the victory of the Jews. The Umbrella Project is another very wonderful project that I've been associated with. I always look at the umbrella as the manifestation of the spirit. We can stand under the umbrella, we cannot. We make that decision ourselves. We don't have to. And we can get out from underneath it if we want also. So I use the umbrella in the Umbrella Project to demonstrate to those that have left behind because of the loss of a loved one. These are regarding people that were primarily killed in 9/11, but it's anyone that was killed in the armed forces. That the spirit of those that have gone are really still here. And we all do watercolors together. And that's the manifestation of those that are gone. We paste them on the inside of the umbrella. Then on the outside, we put our name and then symbols of who and what we are, what we want to be, who we want to become. And what I think about is that the spirit from the inside permeates right through the umbrella and helps the spirits on the outside, which is us. And there is, again, an interplay between the living and the dead. So they're not really gone, they're still here. I did that in Washington, and we're going to bring that around the United States. So far we have it scheduled for Chicago. There's a number of other, as we speak, there's a number of other venues that it's supposedly going to. I don't know where they are going to be, but then our plan is to bring them around the world. And this is in conjunction with the International Brotherhood of Teamsters, which is unusual that the Teamsters would get involved in something like this. But I am a Teamster. I've been involved with and have been a member of the Teamsters Union up until this year, actually. This year I retired from the Teamsters Union at age 70. So, but I'm still an inactive member of the Teamsters. So for many, many years, I was a Teamster, undertaker, artist. So the Teamsters, James Hoffa, and the people in Chicago, John Coley, the head of the Chicago Federation of Labor and the Teamsters Union, have helped me with this particular project. So that's exciting. Walton's Facade was another wonderful project. So as you know, Walton did this crazy, bizarre musical, and people threw all kinds of rotten fruit and everything at it. So they built the wall in front of it, which is a facade, and then they all sang through the microphone. It was, you know, just crazy things. So I was asked to do that for the anniversary, and Lady Walton came over, and we had it at the Art Center in Chicago, which was the old library, a magnificent place. And then it was in the Historical Society in Minneapolis, St. Paul, St. Thomas University used it. So that is still in, I still have that. I did a thing on abortion, pro-life, pro-choice, pro-kill. I showed that at the Miami Art Show. It probably pissed off everybody that came and looked at it, because they were, you know, all, everybody's looking down a stovepipe at that particular issue. So if there are those, these, so my idea was to have these three paintings act as a catalyst and a magnet to bring people away from the political aspects of this into a more academic discussion of what this is about, and to use this as a stepping off space where we can stop hating everybody about this and start talking about it. But, you know, it never worked. Any place that I talked about it, it was, oh, we can't do that, we can't do that. It's too controversial. Hey, what the hell are you talking about? It's too controversial. There it is. No, can't be done. So it's in storage. At some point in time, we might grow to the point where we're able to talk about things instead of hiss at each other. We'll see. Other big projects. I can't think of any right now.
Well, if I look at the at your recent book, about you, under special projects and commissions, I find a list of current milestones in your career. Could we do the following game, that I just read these out and you say something?
Sure.
Talk about the Great Facade.
Yes.
Going back 10 years. The Dance Chicago, 96 and 97.
Well, that's the dance group that we formed. That was, as I said, an interesting history. Those people I met with intensely for a month and just laid down the gauntlet. Young people, there was just too much shit going on, I thought, in art. And we should bring together a synthesization of music, art, and dance on a level that would be about hope and tolerance and peace and all those kinds of things. We then all left each other. 18 months later, out of a clear blue sky, Joe Sirkor called me, who's a wonderful composer and is becoming international. And he said, everything is done, we're incorporated, we've got the dance group, I've written all the music, we are actually in practice, we're doing the whole show, you're gonna have to do all the backgrounds, come over and view it so you know it. Now, wait a minute, what are we talking about? He said, what we were talking about 18 months ago, it's done. So over I went to one of these big dance places, and here's all these people going through this whole thing. And it was about the Holocaust, and it was about, he's Jewish, and it's about how, I think he's Jewish, maybe he isn't, how the people reacted to it and how they were resurrected from it. And that everything that he's done, and the whole group has done, his partner is, Fredo Rivera. He's a wonderful choreographer. And so the synthesization between the two, and now they use a background of these big screens where they flash in all of my paintings, and they actually dance into the paintings. So it's very exciting. So all of those particular venues that are in with the Circle Rivera have to do with this whole program.
Also the Next Generation Dance Project?
Yes, yes. All of those, very exciting. Wonderful, wonderful young people. And they're really going places.
And the Forward Motion?
Exactly the same thing. Yeah, all of those projects.
Okay, we already talked about the Connected House Mary Chapel.
Yes.
Vatican. And it says the victims, two victims of West Cork.
Well, that's the Ngurtum Moor. That's the projects that I said evaporated. They may come back, who knows?
And Benefit, San Francisco, poison girls stuff?
Well, that's a benefit I did for a group of people that I knew out there that owns a bunch of hotels and restaurants. They wanted to do something for the Boys and Girls Club. So I donated a whole bunch of paintings, and we went out there and had an event, and had a lot of people come, and we sold different things. They earned money from it, and it was. I do a lot of that kind of stuff.
And the crystal figures with Sasaki?
Well, that's an exciting program. We've worked on that for 44 years now, and we have developed a group of first eight of my spirits that are encased in glass. They're actually in glass. They're then, after we had the opening a couple months ago in New York, they decided to increase it to, I think, about 24 of the different figures. And those are going to be presented to the United States market through the Sultan Group. So Sasaki China has developed these, and we're at the very beginning of the start now. But we've had 4 years of getting this developed. But it's going to be a very reasonable art object, probably about $100. But what my goal is to get something reasonable into a household, and they'll have things that I've written about each one. Each one is about a spirit. It's about a gift, how we can give gifts of spirit to each of ourselves. So that, you know, as we watch television and read newspapers and magazines, there's a lot of negativism, there's a lot of positivism too. But if we have something constant in our house that's about positive, about giving and about love, it's a constant reminder. For years I had a Buddhist entry piece, we still have it in our house. So as soon as you walked in, you saw the Buddha. And it was really a welcoming love as you walk into the house. So this is sort of an offshoot to that concept.
How about the today's state of the art, of your art? What would you want to say about the pieces you are working on today, at this time? Why are you working on them?
I work out on them because I have to. Because I'm driven to. I love it. It's my passion. It's my mistress. It's what I must do every day. When I don't do it, I become very despondent. And if you go to shows, you can feed on that for a while, but after a while it becomes very redundant, asking the same questions, talking about the same things. It's good, but the best part of being an artist is making art. You know, if you're a horseback rider, you ride a horse. If you're a driver, you drive a car. If you're an artist, you make art. So that's what I do. I make art. I work all the time at what I do. It's a complete and utter passion for me, because it's a complete discovery all the time. Every day there's something new. I never know what's going to present itself to me. I go in with some sort of a preconceived notion quite often, but now I'm going to make minimal. When I look at it, it's so far from minimal that it's, you know, it isn't minimal. And the other times, something is very minimal, and I think it was going to be very, it's going to be, I'm going to dictate what it is. I don't know what's going to happen each day, and that's the exciting part about it. Each day is a complete adventure, because each day I'm presented with a new problem, a new idea, a new form, a new substance. But they all harken back to the world that I've created, that I think is the spirit world. And I know the spirit has no body, but trapped in this body, I have to come up with something. So this is my imaginative.
Where do you see your paintings today? How have they changed comparing them to past years? Do you work with different materials today?
No, they're basically the same materials. Well, for the last 15 years or so, they've basically the same materials. That may be an addition or a subtraction. I used to move in my own mind this far. Now I move paper thin in my process, in my trying to figure out in my mind. So there aren't the big moves, but the moves that I do make are so exciting to me because they're so minimal that probably no one else sees them except me. But that's what's so exciting about it. To move a line or to not move a line or to leave it or not leave it, and it's immediate. There it is. Walking away, what I have found while I'm composing something, it is so difficult for me not to do something. So my growth has been leaving it alone after I've done something and let it speak for itself. For years, I didn't have the authority within myself to think that anyone would know what I'm trying to say. So I try to say the whole thing, because that's the way I am. Like, you know, it's very apparent that we're sitting in a room on the top of a hill in Ireland. But I have to say, you know, we're sitting in a room on the top of a hill in Ireland. That's a light above me, and I'm sitting in a chair. Why do you have to do that? Probably because I have to do it, because I have to reassure myself that this is where I really am. So I have to then assume that everybody else needs that sort of reassuring. So to be able to step back. And then I think, is this too elitist? Because I believe that the lords of the art world will take something and say, well, we understand it. You know, there's four of them. The whole rest of the world doesn't. But because we do, it's great. So the whole world bows and says, oh, yes, yes. Well, you know, I've been too involved with people that I know where bullshit is and where it isn't. Some of that is bullshit. But it's about exclusion and not inclusion. And I think I'm more of an inclusionist than an exclusionist. And that's why I think to myself. And these are all, again, you're going through a thought process of a very confused person. Because I'm thinking, why are you doing this? Are you doing this to be more elitist? Are you doing this really to be more, people should discover more? Do they know enough to discover it? Do they care enough to discover it? Should I really say it? Apple pie and the American flag are good. Don't say that in front of everyone. There isn't many things that you can't say in front of everybody. But this again is part of my confusion. I haven't worked it out, and I never will work it out, because I don't know why we do things. And one of my curses is to rethink it too often. Rose always says, forget it and go on. The older I get, the more I'm able to forget it and go on, maybe because I just do forget it. But But she's been my salvation in so many of these things. You know, forget about it. Who gives a shit? You know, I can mouth those words, but I give a shit, you know? Do they really get it when they see it? The answer to that is no.
Before you said that you hate labels and you don't like to be put into either avant-garde or outsider art or whichever genre one could think of when observing your art. But you've been yourself been labeled as the father of a new school of art, generationalist art. Would you want to define generationalist art?
Generational art to me is the dying of one generation so the next generation come forward. Again, it comes back to my basic philosophy of life, that we build, we become, other people become from us. And, you know, if you watch the series I, Claudius, you'll see how generations get ahead. They got ahead by killing each other. And the gradual bringing down of someone so somebody else can replace them. So one generation must die for the next generation to come forward. That's part of life. That's part of death. So death is clearing out so that the next people can come along. And that's why, to me, the just on an aside with the funeral business, this, we're going to freeze people and bring them back. Who the hell is going to bring them back? You know, great, great, great grandchildren, so this old fool can come back and reclaim everything that he had before? That's crazy. They're going to pull the plug before they bring him back. So, so the generations. What my painting is about is painting over painting over painting. So the parts of it survive and other parts go away. They're still there, like history is still there. But it's a collage, but it's a collage that you don't know is a collage because you can't see through it. So that when I look at a painting, and it takes me anywhere from a minimum of over 1 year, 1 to 3 to 4 years to complete a painting. So the part of that painting has to die so the other part can come forward. And it's putting one plane over another plane over another plane. And then finally, this presentation comes forward that I say to myself, this is as good as I can make it right now. I sign it, and that's the end of it. And then it goes on. And then I start again. There's one painting that I worked on for about 15 years, and it just, I still have it. And I'm never completely satisfied with it, because I just look at it, and I have yet to sign it. That's unusual. But it's something that, to me, some of my best paintings are the ones that fought me constantly. They did not want to be finished. And I didn't want to finish them because I didn't know how to finish them. I didn't know where finishing was. People will say, well, how do you know it's done? I don't know how it's done, but I just know it is done. And in most cases, it's very easy. In some cases, it's difficult. But that's generational. Painting is a process. So if that's the way I do a process, you'd say, well, he's a generational painting. He's a spray painter. He paints with a roller, whatever that means. It means that the process is one of painting over painting over painting. The generation is that one painting dies for the other one to live. As we looked at my gallery, my studio the other day, and I was putting a coating of the varnishes in, that again is another generation. Even though it's so slight, but it is another generation because there is a slight change in the hue, It will darken a little bit. It will also be able to take, especially Asia Red, number one red, and move that from one place to another. So I can make a very yellow, almost a very light orange. Or I can take that red and put it onto a blue and make a little bit of purple. Even though it might have sat for months. So those generations are still building. So that's what I mean by generational. But to say, it's like saying all Irishmen are drunks. You know, all other people are whatever. You know, some people are all stupid.
When did this term generational painting first appear?
Well, because I talked about that's how I labeled it. That was my label. I said these are generations. How do you explain what you do? Well, it's like a generation. One generation must die for another generation to come forward. So I don't know if it's generally used or not. It's probably not, because who would use it? The academic world certainly wouldn't use it. And the people don't know anything about painting, you know, they don't know what it's going to be about anyway. Or care. But it's an easy way for me to explain what I do. So that's what that is. But I just don't like a cookie cutter approach to anything. I hate when people say, you know, one of the things that drives me crazy is Catholic and non-Catholic. Let's talk about men and non-men, women and non-women. Yeah. What are we talking about here? Non-what? All these different labels, they immediately set up something in us that is, well, maybe it's positive, I don't know. It's able to categorize things, which is fine. It's a beginning point. But does it harken back to the caste system? Are we always going to be there? Can we never? I know for a lot of people, I'm a drunk. You know, because when I was a drunk, I was drunk. But I'm still a drunk to a lot of people. Oh, I am the drunk. You never get out of it. Eh, so what? But I think it offends me. I think that part of it offends me. Is because, you know, once you have, you are somewhere, you can never go somewhere else. You will never be any different. The clothes, put it in a steel box, lock it up, there it is.
Let's get to a broader picture even. What is your general outlook on the purpose of art, the purpose of the artist as such? Not in your case.
Well, I would find it very difficult to tell people what art's supposed to be, an artist is supposed to be. I think, you know, if I had to say something about it is, here's a green couch, I like to have a yellow painting. That's great. Paint the yellow painting, put it over the green couch. So you've accomplished something, the person's happy, the artist is happy. And there it is. There are other, when you go into the Metropolitan Museum of Art, you'll go and you'll see a ripped canvas, a big canvas with a rip in it. And then you go to a Balinese artist, and there's got to be 100,000 figures in it. You know, I bought one of them when I was over in Bali. Blah, you know. Figure after, and all just meticulously, wonderfully painted, and that's art. So here's art and here's art. And everything in between is art. So I'm working at making that step. There's some things that I can't appreciate. I can't appreciate somebody taking a fan and throwing paint in it and have it blow it on. And that's fine, that's art. But the thing that bothers me as an old businessman is when you sell it for $100,000 or $50,000 or whatever, that's an economic event. So what is behind that? Let's get 80 fans. Let's get 1,000 fans. Then, you know, if everybody loves it, that's great. Is that art? It's more like painting walls, I think. But I haven't grown to that point where I can make that determination. And I don't know if I want to spend the time thinking about it. I did think about it, you know, in my last 20 years. And I just think, oh, yeah, to hell with it. What's the difference does it make? So what? It is what it is. For me, for my art, it's the delving inside of me to find what I'm thinking about, what I'm trying to work out in my own life, what I'm trying to project to the world as to my experiences in my life. Because this is about, it's about one person, and this person has many different filters in front of them. So they've seen the world in their own filters, and then I present it. People argue with me about my art a lot of times. Say, ah, it's not about that, it's about this. It's great. Because that's what really it's about, as far as I'm concerned. It's about the conversation. It's the beginning of the step to talk to other people, but primarily to yourself. Can you really talk about yourself? Can you open up that box I talked about in the shelf that says all people are drunk? Open it up and look in. Maybe they aren't. If you say that to yourself, you open up a vast worry. Maybe I'm wrong on this. I might be wrong on something else. God forbid that happens. Because that makes me then fallible. Then I'm infallible.
Taking us a little bit towards the issue of academic versus self-taught art, how does this apply to your work and to the larger art world?
Well, I'm not a great academic person, as I told you before. I could hardly get out of school. I don't learn by reading books. I learn by making mistakes. I learn by doing. So I think that, you know, most people couldn't get where I am by doing what I did. Because it's harder. It's harder to do that than it is to be able to find an answer, look it up. I can't find those answers. I can find general. So, you say, here I am with art institutes and I'm teaching a class. That's crazy. Here's an untrained artist teaching somebody. I'm not teaching them. What I'm talking about is possibilities of to be able to develop yourself. And I think that art is the development of the internal person and the manifestation of that onto some sort of a surface. And whether we put that into a school, or we put it into a cast of some sort, we put it into a group that are going to now become apprentices, no matter how we cloak it, it's still going to be the same thing. The finding Now, I'm talking about you, my own art. The finding of that within yourself to be able to present to the world. I think it's very interesting to be able to learn how to mix things, what's going to happen when you, the longevity of the paint, archival glue, all of those things.
I really wonder for myself how much academic art can be a taught art. I wonder whether every student who is studying art isn't also a self-taught artist afterwards, because how much can a professor teach you about
I don't know, because it's got to have your own stamp on it. And when it comes to, this whole thing about experimental, this is experimental, we don't know what's going to happen. Go and look at the pyramids. Remember, it says, woe is those who look at this, you will, forever be damned by mighty me. They don't even know who it is. They don't even know who it is. And here's this thing crumbling. And it's out in the desert, and there isn't any rain falling at it or anything like that. So, when the Statue of Liberty was falling apart, that's metal forever. So, there isn't anything forever.
Can we come to another point? You being a painter and a businessman, two lives inside of yourself. What are some thoughts of yours on business, on the business world versus the art world, comparison, contrast, commerce, business of art?
Is he a businessman that thinks he's an artist, or an artist that thinks he's a businessman? That's the great dilemma that I've worked with for a long time. I don't really care anymore. There is no business of art. When you look at the art world, the artists and the philosophy of the art world, the genre of the art, the way, the culture of the art world has nothing to do with business. It has to do with the free flow of whatever is going on. When you look at the business of art, that comes from the selling of art. Now that's a whole different situation. How are you going to sell a piece of art? That's a business sense. That's a business decision. And let's do it by exclusionary, or let's do it by inclusionary. Let's do it by keeping the product off of the... let's not make too much of this, because if we do, it dilutes the number of pieces. If you only make three, I can get X number of dollars for them. If you make 30, it goes down. You make 300, it's not worth nothing. So, there's all kinds of things that you talk about when you're when you're talking about the business of art. And all you have to do is to go into different galleries, and you get the different ways. Now they're going to have, here's this painting. How much is it? $250,000. But now we have limited edition prints. Ba-ba-boom. There's only going to be 500 of these. Now, if you buy from 1 to 50, those are only going to be $1,000. Once they get to 50 to 150, now they're going up to 2,000. You're buying a stock is what you're buying. And they paint this picture. And they finally get the last one. Then once that, they're all going to be worth $25,000. And you get dazzled with all that. And here, sign this, it's $62.80 a month for 40 months. You and your wife sign it. We just put it on your MasterCard. That's the business of art. That's selling something that, whatever it is. Might as well be timeshare. And why would this sell for $10,000 or $15,000 or whatever the heck it would sell for? Things are what they are, and they're worth what they're worth. So at one point, what the art world put a urinal on the wall and said, this is art. And then everybody, hooray, this is art, this is what we're going to do. One of the critics that was going to, somebody asked to look at my work, said, I don't look at any work unless the artist is dead for at least 50 years. You know, maybe that's true. Who knows? I don't know. I know what business is, and I know what art is. And I don't think they have anything to do with each other. I think they're as far out as they can be. The business of art does not exist. Till it comes down to the business of selling art, now that's a different story. And then, you know, all you have to do is go out and research it. It's an easy research.
But why don't you tell us some little stories about the business of selling art?
The business of selling art.
How did your first sale?
Oh, the first sale was a fellow that, a private agent, had all my art in my home. And this agent had brought in people, and this guy had bought a number of pieces. And the most I had gotten for anything was about $600-$700. And I had a small watercolor. And it was, in fact, it's in the book. It's about the fighting between the Americans and the Nazis, World War II. And it was very dear to me. It was on the wall. And the guy had picked out three or four pieces, and he wanted this one. And I said to the agent, he can't have that. He said, that's my favorite piece. You can't have it. He said, well, he wants it. So Simone Nathan, who had worked with me from the very beginning, she was my mentor and my one that I always turned to. She was a woman that left the being a nun and married a divorced Jew and became, and she was an artist. She was a very fine artist. And then she was a public relations person. And I had a very responsible, her and her husband. So I called her up. I said, this guy is here and he wants this piece of art. And she said, well, you have to sell it to him. You know, you're an artist now, you got to sell it. You got to sell it. So tell him it's $2,500. I said, you're out of your mind. Tell him it's $2,500. I said, all right. So I said to the agent, yeah, it's for sale, it's $2,500. She said, you're crazy. I said, that's what it is, $2,500. So she said to the guy, it's $2,500. He said, all right. I said, what do you mean it's all right? I've never sold an oil for $2,500. You're going to buy this little thing for $2,500? You're crazy. He said, yes, I want it. And he bought it, and he still has it. So then I'm in San Francisco. We had a big art show, and this guy and his wife were coming along. And they were there for 4 days. I was about ready to die, you know, at the end of 4 days, talking to people about the art. So I had a big piece, and it was expensive. It was about $15,000-$16,000. And so every day they came, they were looking, talking, and carrying on. So it was hotter than hell. I was standing over by the door. And she's right up close to it, about this far looking at it, and he's over next to me, and he's looking at it. So he turned to me, and I had many conversations with him. He said, well, it's between you and so-and-so. I don't remember who it is. Down the way, we're going to buy a piece of art today, today's the last day. It's either this one or the other one. I said, buy the other one. He said, what? Why should I buy the other one? I said, that's a real tough painting. I said, that is a tough painting. You hang that up on your wall, your brother-in-law is going to think you're crazy. You need a real big set of balls to be able to sell that, to buy that painting and put it in your house. Someone with balls has got to buy that. So, yeah, I said, yeah. He walks up to his wife and says, this is the one we want. Wrap it up. He showed me he got a big set of balls. So, you know, what is it about? The agent there, oh, what'd you tell him? Said he needed balls to buy.
Can you tell us something you remember from your first show?
From my first show? Well, my first show was a huge success. And I sold about, I don't know, 15 pieces or something. Nobody knew what they were looking at, and they probably bought it because they felt sorry for me. It was run out of gallery, and it was a strange story. I was painting like mad, you know. I was getting despondent because no one was seeing the work. And I said to Rose, you know, I'm painting day and night and making all this art, and nobody's looking at it, no matter where we go. And Simone Nathan was working with me, trying to get a place somewhere. So I said, I can ask, my father and mother were both dead. I said, I'm going to ask my father a special favor. And Rose said, no, ask your mother. She gets things done in your family. She was an artist. So I said, okay, I'll ask my mother to see what she could do. But God, about 3 days later, Simone called and said, Renata Gallery, which is a fine gallery, their main artist had a big fallout, and in 2 months they have a big space lined up, and they won't know if you would have a one-minute person show. And I said, would I? When's it going to be? They gave me the date. It was my mother's birthday. It was my mother's birthday. So I called Rose, and she said, didn't I tell you to tell your mother? So there's another sign. They're the spirits. Who knows?
Okay, wrapping up for today. A summation. Looking back, looking forward.
Looking back, no regrets. Looking forward with great anticipation, great excitement. I think that I love my life. There isn't anything I would change. Nothing. There's nothing I'd change in the past. And if I have half of the pleasure in the future, I'll be satisfied. I love it. Love it. I love the people that surround me. I love everything.